Let's Talk podcast guests are invited to share their unique perspectives. The ideas expressed in this podcast do not necessarily reflect the practices of Mesquite ISD and are not an endorsement of any particular agenda or viewpoint.
Welcome to the Let's Talk podcast, inspired by Mesquite ISD's Leadership and Empowerment Team, or LET for short.
Our guests include educators, students, and community members sharing their experiences from their perspectives.
So vamos a tener una conversación real about embracing nuestras diferencias and finding common ground with your hosts, Dr. LaDonna Coley and Ted Madden.
Hello and welcome to another episode of the Let's Talk podcast. We have a very special guest today, a motivational speaker who has worked all over the country. And in August, he was here in Mesquite during our school district's annual convocation. He's a big boy and can introduce himself, so we'll do the introductions the way we normally do. My name is Ted Madden. I'm a video producer for the school district, and I'm a 49-year-old white man.
And my name is LaDonna Gully. I'm the Director of Leadership and Empowerment for Mesquite ISD, and I'm a 52-year-old African-American woman.
And my name is Jeremy Anderson. I'm a educational consultant, speaker, and I'm a 42-year-old African-American man.
All right. Well, we got to see you in August, but tell us a little bit about your background. We always like to build the foundation with our guests so people get to know the guest a little bit. So who are you? Where'd you come from? And where are you now?
Yeah. So Ted and to Dr. Gully, thank you both for having me on. Hello to everybody in Mesquite that's watching or listening to this podcast. I'm really excited to be here. Where I am now, I'm in Atlanta, Georgia, and I'm living the dream. I'm living the dream. Now, I wasn't always traveling and aspiring and motivational. Like, I had quite a few challenges when I was young. Really, Ted, just trying to figure things out, bumping my head. You know, the absence of my biological father. My mom had me at the early age of 16 years old. A drug and alcohol abuse, a diagnosis of ADHD. Like, I struggled a lot. And so now I get to travel the world and share with students how educators capture my heart and help me bounce back. And I also get to work with educators, showing them how their colleagues really capture my heart and show them how they can build relationships with students in every classroom at every school.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, Jeremy, you shared a lot of that during convocation. In fact, I think that so many teachers and just educators overall were really moved by your message of just hope and what teachers do. And so can you talk a little bit about what you feel like every student has to have from a teacher?
Can I give you a few things?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. One is the belief system. You know, I often say, I've kind of coined this phrase, and I have even some t-shirts that say it, and now districts are really buying into the motto and getting them in their colors. It says, teach by faith and not by sight, right? And so one of the biggest things is I encourage and sometimes challenge educators to do is to teach by faith and not by sight. So that's one thing a student needs, is they need an educator that has overcome any biases they might have, that can look at their student regardless of their clothes, regardless of what they may smell like, regardless of their track record, regardless of their past behavior, and see the greatness inside them. Every student needs an educator to believe in the power, the greatness, the promise that is inside their lives. And so I believe that those are two of the main things that educators have to be able to teach by faith and not by sight, because looks can be deceiving, right? And then they've got to really believe. And then with that, they've got to, you know, have patience. Students need educators who are going to be patient with them. Students need educators who are not going to take things personal, you know, when they're having a bad day. And students need educators who realize that those students are humans with thoughts and feelings and emotions. And oftentimes when we see the attitude or the disruption or the misbehavior, it's because their world is in crisis. And so students need educators that have the mental bandwidth to realize that this kid is just lashing out or just upset or just shy or just quiet or just angry for no reason. There's something going on inside the world. And so students need educators that I say that have the bandwidth, right? Because sometimes educators are just tired, they're mentally spent, but they need and deserve educators to have the bandwidth to be able to see them for who they really are and to challenge them to bring out that greatness within.
So for you, who specifically made a difference? Because not all teachers are going to connect with all students. And in our experience here on this podcast, we talk to a lot of different educators who say this coach or this teacher is the one that made the difference. So this is a chance for you to give a shout out to somebody.
Yeah. So I would have to say Mr. Bryant made a huge impact in my life. He was one of my social studies teachers. He was a lot older. He was really corny. You know, his suits were really big. Like, we would always tease him, but his heart, I can't, his jokes were the worst ever. And he would laugh at his own jokes, but his heart was just so pure. And even though he wasn't the cool teacher, you know, there are some cool teachers out here. They got special handshakes and all these cool, he wasn't that, but his heart was there. You know what I'm saying? And he was really rooting for me. So I think about him. I think about Miss Presley, who would let me come. She lived in my neighborhood, so I would be able to come by to her school, to her home from time to time for tutoring, and she would do extra things and was really patient with me. I think about Miss Thomas, who I gave such a hard time, you know, throughout my experience, but she was just still patient and still loving and still kind. So I think about, you know, some of those educators. I think about Mason West, who literally would change his whole classroom because he realized that me and a lot of the other students in my class had short attention spans. We were always cracking jokes and doing pranks and fighting and being disruptive. And so he realized it's not going to be possible for me to stand in front of them and just teach a regular lecture. Like, these kids are not going to be able to receive that. So as he began to teach, he would literally take 20 minutes to teach the concept, and then he would break us up into teams. And then it would be five people per team. And then he would quiz us and do like a trivia, you know, and we would rearrange the whole classroom to where all the desks would go against the wall, and you would have five desks that roll this way, five desks in a row this way with him in the front, kind of like Family Feud with Steve Harvey. And then he would ask a question, and whoever got their hand up could answer it first, and then whatever team got the most points would win. But because we had an hour in the class, and 20 minutes was teaching, and now 40 minutes was to follow up the game, it's something we look forward to. And he was by far our easiest and our favorite teacher. And if I could just share one really cool thing, is I get to work really close with Mason West today. He's worked with universities. He's worked with the government. The government has actually brought him over to different countries, you know, to stop, you know, some of the young terrorism that's taking place. Like, he's a brilliant man. And now he is like the director over this really amazing private school here in Georgia. And I've been able to partner with him. He is one of the contributing writers in our Next Level Students curriculum, and we posted several conferences together. So to see that come around full circle, right, and to see the relationship we have now, it's really magical.
Oh, wow. That is magical. You know, we do have so many of our teachers who I feel are really great listeners. Would you say, though, that that is really one of the keys to reaching some of our hardest students?
Absolutely. I believe that they have to be good listeners and a little nosy too, right? Right? Like, because we have to find the information, because most students don't walk around and say, hey, I'm really upset because my uncle molested me, or hey, I'm really upset because my father left. They kind of keep it to themselves. They have a hard time communicating. So educators have to find innovative ways to get the information out of the students, whether you're tossing a ball around on Friday, and when you get the ball, hey, Patrick, tell me what you're looking forward to. Hey, Hector, what are you looking forward to this weekend? Or if you toss the ball around on Monday and the student grabs a Nerf ball, okay, tell me what significant happened this past weekend. Well, when a student says, man, this past weekend, my mom made baked chicken, broccoli, and mashed potatoes. Well, this teacher is thinking, okay, you had dinner. But to that student, my mom was actually home. My mom actually cooked a meal. It wasn't like fast food or microwavable dinner. If that's the highlight over your whole weekend, is that mom cooked dinner? Like, what type of dysfunction, right? So sometimes we have to listen by asking the right questions and putting ourselves in the best position. If a student grabs a Nerf ball on Friday and says, hey, I'm looking forward to this weekend because this is the weekend that my father has us, Well, now you know that child is in a broken home. Maybe their parents went through divorce. And so now that teacher, maybe they can relate. Maybe that teacher can say, hey, I understand, you know, my parents once went through a divorce. I thought it was my fault. I realized now it wasn't. I hope that's not how you feel. Like, they now have an opportunity to get some information to be able to build a connection. Because it's all about connections, right? I believe before we teach them, we got to be able to reach them. And where I went wrong, which is why I got failed the sixth grade, then got kicked out of one school for the ninth grade, and failed the next year for the ninth grade, and had to go to three different schools, is there wasn't a connection. They were all focused on either addressing my behavior or trying to teach me, but no one, until I went to that third school for the ninth grade, was trying to reach me, right? And so sometimes when we ask these questions and we do these different things to kind of get information out of students, now we know what's going on inside the world. And can I share one more quick piece? I feel like I'm talking a lot. Okay, I'm excited. So this is what I tell educators all the time. If you have a student that's really struggling, they're not really sharing much, but you find out that their world is in crisis and you can relate, there is so much power in saying, hey, Timothy, Sabrina, look, I understand what you have going on. I've kind of been in a similar situation. I'm really proud of you. You're going to get through this. There's a connection. But most probably have a hard time connecting. Most of the educators I've been privileged to work with over the last 13 years say, Jeremy, I don't have a connection. Like, I grew up in a great home. My father was present. We did pretty well for ourselves. By the time I graduated, not only did I have scholarships, but they had money saved up for me to go to college. So I have a hard time connecting with the pain of these students. And so I tell them to own that. I say, because when you sit down with Sabrina and say, hey, Sabrina, I know you're going through a lot right now. And honestly, Sabrina, I can't relate. But I can say this. I am so proud of you. I am so amazed, Sabrina, at how you're handling this. I don't know how I would handle it, Sabrina, if I was in your position, if this happened to me. I just want you to know that I'm proud of you and I'm here for you. And though I can't fully understand it because my situation was different, I see the strength and the resiliency inside of you. You see, at that time, Dr. Gully, that student feels seen. Even though you can't relate, the fact that you can acknowledge, I'm acknowledging that you're dealing with pain. I'm acknowledging that you're in a really challenging predicament right now. But I'm also acknowledging that you're still showing up in your resiliency, and I'm proud of that. That can really work wonders. So I think listening is a really very, very important component. But then, what do we do with the information that we gather? Because there are a lot of educators that are listening, but they might not know what to do with that information. And so I think that applying tools and resources and there are specific things to do once you get the information is also key.
What I've learned in my career as a video producer doing a lot of interviews and throughout my life as a curious person who likes to ask questions, people will talk. I think the default assumption is sometimes that people are going to keep stuff to themselves. But you get them talking, they want to talk. And I think that's another thing we can tell our teachers too, is don't assume the kid is not going to want to engage with you, because they are, especially if you're coming from an honest and authentic place.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. It is so important that we realize that at the end of the day, this is all about the relationship, right? It's all about the relationship that you build with every individual that you walk in and that you come in contact with. And when you take those moments out to really find out, and when you ask someone how they are doing, know that you're going to get a truth. I think that we can't begin or continue to do things by happenstance, or we do things because we do it, right? But that we're really purposeful. What do you say to that, Jeremy?
I would agree 100%, but there are some times when they might say, hey, LaDonna, how you doing? Fine. Come on, LaDonna. You're not doing fine. This is a safe space. I really care about you. I can tell you haven't been yourself this week. What's going on? Nothing. I told you I'm fine. Okay. Well, let me just share this with you, right? Because I know you're saying you're fine, but I sense you're not fine. But I also sense you probably don't feel like talking. Was that accurate? You really don't feel like talking right now? No, I don't. Okay. Well, when you are ready, just know I'm ready to hear. Can I just ask this? Did something happen after school? Is there something going on at home I should know about? or okay, well, when you're ready, I'm here. So sometimes we gotta try to find a way to pull it out of them, because there are those students where you can ask and they can say, I'm fine, there's nothing wrong with me, but there's clearly something wrong with you. My daughter is 10 and she's going through all these different changes and attitudes, and one morning she wakes up in a great mood. Hey, Daddy. The next morning I'm like the evil villain. I'm like, what did I do? What's wrong? Nothing. I'm like, Lord have mercy. Like, so I gotta be tapped in with my baby girl to kind of really see what's going on. And another thing, if I can also share this, scientists say that the human brain is not even fully developed until the age of maybe 22 to 25. So sometimes when we've got students who are 9 or 10 or 13 or 17, and we're like, well, why don't they get it? Like, their brain is still kind of developing and they don't quite see the world the way that you do. And so I think sometimes we got to give them a little bit more grace and be a little bit more tactful with how we address them, so that we can really build that relationship.
I'm listening to that as a parent. Do you remember that when you're parenting your kids, that the brain isn't fully developed? Because it frustrates me when I'm saying, all you got to do is this, and oh, it'll God. Be fine.
Right. And my daughter's like, I did. I'm like, baby, you did it. And then I remember, like, well, she's 12. I mean, she's 10. Like, she's not, you know, as sharp as she is. Like, they don't see the same world that we do. Yeah.
That's a good lesson for me, at least, to take away from this podcast. Let me ask you this. We in Mesquite, we're a school district that is largely free and reduced for the lunch for the students who go to our schools. Do you tend to speak to school districts who have students who maybe have a similar background as you did growing up, or do you kind of talk to the spectrum of all levels?
I talk to the spectrum of all. I've literally spoken in every type of school, from Catholic schools to private schools to charter schools to rural schools, right? In country towns and big city, inner city, like, I've done it all. And one thing I can find is that though my message, depending on the school, is different, because every school is different, you know, there are some challenges. I go to some where it's like 100% free or reduced lunch, you know, and, you know, 95% of the students are black and brown. And so then I go to some schools, especially like over on the West Coast. I've been to several schools where they're like in the Cali area, in the suburbs. But so I'm sitting down with them and they like, yep, we don't have any gang issues. We don't have any fighting issues, but we do find cocaine in the bathroom. We do find powder. We do find kids cutting. We do find the pill popping, like the depression. So though they're not hungry for food, they're hungry for love. Though they're not looking for shelter or for reasonable transportation, they've got that, but there's something missing within their heart. And so the pills and the cocaine and some the designer drugs, because they've got money, right? And so I find it interesting, like, I go to every type of school, but at all the schools I go to, I find one common thing, is that this next generation is hurting. So whether they're hurting because of violence in the community or because of outside, you know, temptations, or whether they're hurting because of who's not present in the home. There are some schools I go to where it's like 60% of the students don't have a father present in the home. But then there are some schools I go to where the father is physically present, but not emotionally present. Right. And so, yeah, I've literally been in, I believe, every type of school scenario that there is. And in all of them, amazing and beautiful students who just need, you know, a little bit more push to challenge them to the next level.
Right. It's so interesting that you say that, because I was at a training last week, and you had a host of different people from organizations, including our U.S. Army, and just a CPS, I mean, just an array of different fields. And all of these people were coming in to really kind of find out and look at asset development and asset building of young people, and how do we begin to look at our young people differently. And that was what I noticed. I noticed this, it doesn't matter where you are, where you live, in our country, we definitely, something is going on and happening with our young people. And I don't want to say that we're blind to it, but I think that we are starting to see some of the remnants as a result of COVID. But we really have to stop and pay attention and ask ourselves, what are we doing? What are we modeling? What are we embodying in terms of getting our students and helping our students be able to connect and plug into what we have to offer.
Absolutely. And they're looking for it, though they don't know that they're looking for it, you know. And you know, I've referenced a few times, you know, educators having the mental bandwidth. I hope that none of them listening will feel that I don't believe that they are like mentally sound. I'm not saying that. I found that more educators really struggle with self-care and temple care. And when I go to convocations and school districts and I do professional development, I ask a question before I do this part of the training. I say, hey, how many of you all last year, there were 5 to 10 times that you came to school and you were just, before the school day started, you pulled up mentally spent, arguing with your family, in tears driving in, 90% of the hands go up. And so I do that to try to let them know, like, for one, you're human and you're not the only person that's struggling. But to kind of paint a picture, it's hard when your own world, you can get that diagnosis, you can suffer from anxiety, depression, and your own kids can lose their mind, and you can bump heads with your spouse, and your own body might be going through some changes, or you can get sick, but you also have to be in tune with the students, and that can be very challenging. So I talk often about, you know, educators doing the work that they have to do within to take care of themselves, to put themselves in the strongest, healthiest position so that they have the mental bandwidth, right? Because there are a lot of educators across America that show up to school and feel when Monday comes around, they're like, oh, it's Monday. Like, that's no way to live, right? And so it's like, what do we have to do to support them? And what do they have to do to support themselves so that when Monday comes around, they can say, all right, I'm ready for the challenge. I know it's not going to be a cakewalk, but I'm excited to be in this school to connect with the hearts and minds of this next generation. And that takes some work.
Exactly. Well, and I would tell you, when you were here, first of all, you were absolutely wonderful. I cannot tell you how many people came up to me afterward like, oh my gosh, where did you guys even find him, right? And you talked a lot about our Mesquite Promise. You saw it, you looked at it, you reviewed it, and you really mentioned to me very specifically like how you were like awed by like, wow, you guys are really making it really intentional about what you believe about students.
You know, I've never been to a district that had a promise, you know, like the Mesquite Promise. And I think that was so refreshing. You know, the fact that we're letting these students know, like, you matter, you know, you belong here, you know what I'm saying? And there is greatness inside you. Like, there are dreams and great things that you're gonna do out here in the world. You know, and when we have that mindset, however we wanna remix it and we personally embody it, or we believe like every single one of you students belong here, you know what I'm saying? And you deserve to feel loved and valued, and there are dreams and ideas and aspirations inside of you, and it's our responsibility to help to bring that out, to help put you up on the platform, because we're gonna change the world together. Like, the heart of the Mesquite Promise is utterly refreshing. And so when that was first shared with me, I was just like, man, this is what we're pushing. This is what we're promoting, like, collectively. And I kind of chatted with a few people. They're like, yeah, you know about the Mesquite Promise? I was like, you know about the Mesquite Promise? So, yeah, it was really refreshing to see.
All right. I know we've got a hard out. You've got things to do. You're a very busy man. We appreciate all the time. But everybody always has time for a little self-promotion. Tell us where people can find you on social media and your website.
Yep. So my website is jeremyanderson.org. Jeremyanderson.org. I'm easy to find. I'm all over Google. If you do Twitter, it's like @1JeremyAnderson. I'm pretty easy to find. And if I could just give a closing remark, a closing statement. So to every educator, you know, that is within the Mesquite School District, like, thank you for what you do. I know how challenging it is. I know how hard it is. And I also know that when you do the hard work within, when you take complete ownership with what happens inside your classroom or your office, when you take complete ownership of what happens inside your school, when you take complete ownership of what happens inside your life, as you're more disciplined, because you might have to start saying no to some other people, to some other things, so you can say yes to your family. What I don't want is for you to give your school your best and your family the rest. I believe that you can have an amazing school year, but also have an amazing life. I believe that if you take care of yourself and you do the proper work and you get the right type of rest, and you're drinking lots of water, and if you find a safe outlet to talk to someone, counseling, therapy, a best friend, and you begin to shift your perspective about life. I don't have to go to the school and teach on Monday. I get to go to the school and teach on Monday, right? Like I believe that when you do those things, you'll start to feel differently on the inside, and that will show on the outside when it comes to the characteristics of your students. To every educator that might feel like, I'm not really sure if I'm moving a needle, like, listen to me, you are. If I could change one thing about my past, I wish all those educators over the years that tried their best to connect with me, and it just did not happen in that season, I wish they could see me now. And so the work that you do day in and day out does matter, and you are changing lives one student at a time. And it's been an honor to be with you all. Thank you so much.
Hey, thank you.
Absolutely.
Thanks, Jeremy. That's Jeremy Anderson, a motivational speaker on a mission to inspire his audiences to get to the next level. Thank you very much. It's time now for Just a Moment, this weekly segment we do with LaDonna. And LaDonna, we are curious what you have to say, and you have a tough act to follow.
I know, right? Very tough. I agree. But you know what, though? I was going to talk about one thing, but then in the moment of us having the conversation with Jeremy, I realized, I said, you know what? Something he kind of alluded to was the opportunity and the courage to become uncomfortable. I think that this is really important, not only for educators, but for every single one of us to just begin to start thinking about, you know what, I think it's okay for me to begin to create some brave spaces to have some uncomfortable conversations. And we have to begin to talk to each other and to really engage differently. I know that a lot of us are doing this in silos, and we're doing this in really small groups, as we should, right? Because we want to feel safe in that space. But I do want to challenge us as we go into our workplaces, as we have opportunities to share, that we really begin to say, you know what, I'm okay with a question being posed to me that I can be somewhat uncomfortable about, but that I'm going to use a level of patience, a level of openness, empathy, and my listening skills to really be able to engage and provide some information that will be enlightening and will also offer a different perspective.
Words of wisdom. Thank you, as always. Yeah. I don't want to say thank you. It sounds like you're a guest when I do that to you.
I know.
What else will be a better way to dismount? I'll work on that for next week. All right. Well, if you enjoy it.
I appreciate you.
Of course. Well, I appreciate you. If you enjoy the podcast, please like us on social media. You can go to the podcast platform, rate and review. That helps get the word out. More people can listen as well. If you've got questions for us, comments, our email address is letstalk@mesquiteisd.org. You can find us on social media using the search term LetMISD. For Dr. LaDonna Gulley, I'm Ted Madden. Let's talk again next week.